Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Ranger by William Stacey. Narrated by Cris Dukehart. Prologue. Eastern Russia, 2 months after the Culling. Major Valentin Mikhailovich Volkov sat in the turret of his 8-wheeled GAZ-5923 armored personnel carrier, squinting through the gusting, filthy gray snow. On his right, perilously close, was the lip of the embankment, a steep fall down the mountain to certain death. 3 times now his convoy had almost lost a bus over the treacherous cliff, forcing them to move at a crawl. His military vehicles with their snow chains were much better suited for this wet, dirty sludge than the civilian vehicles wedged between them. But they needed the other vehicles to move everyone. And if they didn't escape the mountains tonight, they'd all die. Behind him, he made out the closest of the armored trucks, but none of the buses, trucks, and tractors that followed them. What he saw, even through the storm, was the glowing summit of Mount Achinsky, less than 8 kilometers away. The true eruption had yet to occur, but Valentin knew it was coming.
If we're still in the mountains when the volcano blows. Come on, Leo.
20 minutes ago, he sent Leo forward in his armored reconnaissance car to clear the half kilometer to the H7 tunnel, the final pass that led onto the plains of Kamchatka Peninsula. For 8 weeks, they hadn't dared to break out from their mountain refuge, a small mining village. But the storm and the ash must have grounded the elves' winged monsters, because so far their trip was firestorm-free. But that didn't mean the route was safe. Their enemy didn't need to fly to hold the tunnel against them. He activated his radio, yelling into the mic over the wind.
Leo! Leo, come in! Send sit-trip!
There was no answer. The lack of a response wasn't by itself a cause for concern. Radio reception had turned to shit in the storm, but Leo should have been back by now. They couldn't just sit here exposed like this. They were running out of time.
So do something. You're in charge, aren't you?
He dropped inside the turret, thankful to get out of the wind. 2 other soldiers shared the vehicle, his driver, Maxim, and Dimi, sitting in the turret's gunner's seat. Dimi was no more a common soldier than Valentin was, but these days everyone performed whatever task was necessary, and operating the gun was critical. The vehicle was designed to hold only 7 soldiers, but there were at least 12 civilians, women, children, babies, wedged in the back, miserable and frightened. There was no other choice. Dimi met his gaze, his arm resting on the firing mechanism of the 30-millimeter Shipunov cannon.
Captain Igorov?
He asked. Valentin shook his head.
Maxim?
He yelled to the other man sitting forward of the turret. When the young man, still in his teens, looked back over his shoulder, and Valentin was certain he was listening, he spoke slowly, making sure both men understood.
You and Dimi stay here. Let no one out. I'm going on foot to find Leo. Remember, keep everyone buttoned up. We may need to hurry. Is it the elves?
Maxim asked, a hint of panic in his voice. Maxim, a native of the Caucasus, had served as Valentin's driver since the night the sky flashed green and everything had gone to hell. In that time, he had proven himself a solid, if unremarkable, soldier. Valentin smiled like a stern father.
No, even monsters don't go out into storms.
Dimi reached out and gripped Valentin's leg from where he sat in the cramped turret.
Boss, I'll come.
Valentin shook his head.
No, you stay here and keep the civilians calm. No need for anyone else to freeze his balls. I'm just going down the road, take a quick look. I'll come right back. That's a stupid idea.
Valentin smirked as he pried Dimi's hand from his leg.
I'm in charge. I get to make stupid decisions. Don't worry. I'll be quick.
Dimi grunted and bit his lip, but nodded.
If Leo's stuck in a snowbank, I'll kick his skinny ass.
Valentin climbed out of the turret, exposing himself once more to the biting winds. He pulled his balaclava down over his face, ensuring he could see through the eye holes. Then he clambered down the icy side of the fighting vehicle before scanning the dark skies once more. seeing nothing but ash and snow. He was about to step off when Demi appeared through the hatch, holding an assault rifle by the barrel so Valentine could take the stock.
Boss?
Demi said in exasperation, reminding him of his mother.
Please.
Valentine took the weapon and worked the action to make sure a round was chambered.
I didn't forget, Demi. Just checking. Good job.
Right.
The other man shook his head and dropped back inside the turret. He had forgotten it, but in his defense, his thoughts were becoming increasingly distracted these days. Too little sleep and too many lives depending on him. Valentine pushed his way through a half foot of dirty gray sludge, thicker, wetter, and slicker because of the ash. Without the snow, they'd probably have already suffocated.
God saves those who love him.
He set off, squinting into the wind, but made it only about 100 meters before he heard a voice cry out behind him, just audible above the howling winds. 4 shapes materialized out of the blowing snow. Valentine sighed. Demi must have told Andre what he was doing.
Of course he had.
As the forms approached, he recognized his second-in-command, Senior Lieutenant Andre Gromov. Gromov had wrapped a tan desert scarf around his face, but his clever blue eyes flashed with displeasure.
Major,
he said,
has your head frozen? The elves hate the cold more than we do. With God's blessing, they'll freeze to death. That may be, but we're coming with you.
The 2 men on either side of Andre were Stanislav Popov and Timur Semenov, senior sergeants from the 36th Battalion Tactical Group. While neither man had been part of his team, each had distinguished himself in the brutal fighting over the last 8 weeks. Without a word, both sergeants stepped past Valentine and Andre, their rifles held in the ready position as they moved down the snow-swept mountain road. The final man wasn't a man, or even a soldier, although she wore the comically oversized uniform of one. Anna Dominika Galkinia was a thin and mousy 19-year-old, a daughter of a miner. She carried no weapon, but her God-given gift had saved all of their lives more than once. Someone, Andre probably, had lent her a helmet to wear, which was ridiculously large on her small head. The men considered Dominika their guardian angel. Valentine met her gaze.
Anything?
She closed her eyes, then opened them a moment later before shaking her head.
No magic. At least, nothing like the elves, but the air is very different. Hard to describe, it feels like something is changing. The entire world has changed.
Andre yelled over the wind. Valentine reached out and pulled Dominika closer, then put his lips near her ear.
If you sense anything.
She bobbed her head.
Yes. Yes, Major. I am the canary in the mine.
He smiled.
A brave canary.
They moved forward, the 2 senior enlisted soldiers leading the way. Valentine and Andre followed with Dominika in the rear where they could protect her. Although, if he were being honest, she was by far the most dangerous of them all. Despite his initial annoyance with Andre for coming, he was thankful for the backup. When your enemy could turn invisible and kill you with a gesture, a wise man used every tool at his disposal. Thunder boomed, causing him to jump, his heart racing. Ahead, far too close, a barrage of what must have been chain lightning flashed through the blowing snow, leaving the stench of ozone in the air.
What kind of snowstorm has thunder and lightning?
The men paused, exchanging worried glances with one another. Dominika stared wide-eyed at him.
It's something, she said.
Not like the elves, but unusual.
Valentine stared ahead, knowing they had to be almost at the tunnel. Once they were through it, they'd be free of the enemy, and it'd be a clear path all the way to Petropavlovsk.
And what will you do then?
Since that green light flashed through the sky. Judgment Day. It's as if you and the others are alone in this world. What will you tell them if Petropavlovsk is abandoned? And how will you stop the elves from coming after you?
Thunder rumbled once more, so close Valentine's bones shook. More chain lightning struck the cliffs ahead of them where the tunnel lay.
Come on.
Valentine motioned the men forward. There was no going back. As they approached the pass, the right embankment rose and became a cliff, cutting off the blowing snow and revealing the four-wheeled Gaz armored reconnaissance car sitting in the middle of the highway less than 30 meters away.
Leo's car.
Valentine exchanged a wary glance with Andre. Dominica shook her head, showing the area was still clear of the enemy. Maybe. They crept closer to the vehicle. Its small turret with its 14.5mm heavy machine gun was facing forward, and the engine was running. The tunnel should have been only a couple hundred meters away, but a bright light, like headlights, only more powerful, flared through the snow. Something was wrong here. A figure sat in the crew commander's hatch, peering forward so intently he didn't see them approaching from behind. Valentine slapped the ice-crusted side of the vehicle with his gloved hand.
Hey!
It wasn't Leo, but his driver, a young private. The man jerked in fright, his eyes wide.
What happened here?
Valentine slung his rifle on his shoulder, then climbed up the vehicle, hanging onto the small turret.
What was this boy's name? Igor? No. Ilyushin?
Major,
he said in a voice filled with relief.
Praise to God.
What's going on, Ilyushin? Where's your boss? Where's Captain Igorov?
The private pointed ahead with a trembling gloved hand.
He and Peter, I mean Senior Sergeant Burry, went forward on foot when they saw the glow. It's been a long time. I've been calling and calling on the radio.
Valentine reached up and squeezed the young man's forearm.
The storm's shitting on our comms. What did he tell you to do? Mend the gun, watch the pass, and wait. He said they'd be right back, but it's been too long.
Valentine peered forward, seeing nothing but the bright light haloed by the blowing snow. Had the enemy taken shelter within the tunnel? Maybe set fires before it, or was this more of their deviltry?
Okay, Lucian, we'll take over. I'm sorry, Major. I should have done something, checked on them. No, you did the right thing. We'll find the captain and your friend.
Relief washed over his face.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Major. Good. Stay here. Keep your finger off that thing's trigger. I don't want you shooting us. You hear me? Yes, Major.
Valentine joined Andre and the others, pulling them into a close huddle.
I don't know what's happening here, but Leo and Peter are missing. Be ready for the worst. If you even suspect an invisible foe, throw a grenade and start shooting. Understand?
They all nodded, including Dominica, her large eyes filled with resolve.
Okay, here's the plan. We're not here to fight. We look, then we move back. If the enemy is in the tunnel, we bring the vehicles forward and execute an assault. There's no going back now, clear?
Clear, boss,
said Andre.
I'll go first. The shit you will,
said Valentine as he turned about and slipped forward, bringing his rifle to his shoulder, his thumb on the safety selector. The others followed behind. His toes were going numb, as were his fingers and his wet gloves, but he ignored them, pushing on. As they moved closer to the bright light, the stench of ozone hung in the air. They froze at the sudden bone-chilling primal cry of rage that ripped through the wind, and Valentine's immediate fear was trolls. But no troll had ever screamed that loudly. They remained motionless, listening. Valentine switched the fire selector on his rifle to automatic. For several minutes, they heard nothing more. Valentine edged forward once again. His boot caught against something in the snow, and he almost fell forward. He bent down and brushed the snow away from the obstacle before realizing in horror it was a body. He stared into Leo's dead face. His grief surged. He and Leo had gone through selection together in the Urals, fought in a half dozen different shitholes, and drunk far too much vodka. Dropping beside his friend, he pushed more of the snow away, exposing Leo's ruined torso. His chest caved in as though a car had run him over. Andre moved farther ahead, then dropped beside another snow-covered corpse. Peter, Leo's gunner. At least Valentine thought it was Peter. The head was gone. He removed a glove and placed the back of his hand on Leo's cheek.
Still warm.
He rose, choking back his sorrow. There was no time for such things. The children. God help him, everyone depended on him. Dominica placed her lips near his ear. The light. The lightning is not natural.
Boss,
hissed Andre.
Something's coming.
The giant lurched out of the blowing snow and Valentine's breath caught in his throat. At least three times the height of a man, it walked upright on two stunted but powerful legs. A 6-foot tree trunk shorn of branches rested across its wide shoulders. White fur covered its thick arms from the huge shoulders down to the oversized biceps and across its wide chest. Its head was manlike but bald, misshapen, with beady black eyes set too far apart on either side of a nose that looked as if it had been crushed flat by a rock. A single thick tusk sprouted from a too wide mouth, below which hung a long matted white beard. It wore a patchwork of stitched-together furs, and more skins were wrapped around each of the giant's elephantine feet. For several heartbeats, they all stared at one another. Men, woman, and giant. Then rage flashed through the monster's eyes, and it lifted its club high overhead, screaming what sounded like a single word.
Gog Magog!
The giant charged, and Valentine, a veteran of many battles, froze, like a recruit. As the club swept up, he now understood how Leo had died. Dominica saved them. Fire blossomed from her outstretched hands to wash over the giant's face. It screamed in pain, its beard and much of the skin from its face charred. Someone shoved Valentine, sending him flying into the snow as the club whistled down where he had been standing. A long burst of automatic rifle fire cut through the night. Valentine rolled over, came up on one knee and brought his rifle to his shoulder, just as the giant smashed someone down with its club, snapping bones and ending a life. A fireball struck the giant's chest, washing over its torso, and Valentine saw Dominica stand her ground. Someone else opened fire. Valentine did the same, sending short bursts into the giant. The giant screamed, lashing out once more with its weapon and sending another man flying.
We're only angering it.
He put his fire selector on single fire and put aimed shots into the giant's face. This time the giant staggered back, howling as it tried to protect its head, but at this range there was no way Valentine could miss. Another fireball struck it, and the giant spun about before falling onto a knee and trying to cover its head from the flames with its arms. Valentine emptied the last of his magazine into the back of its skull from only a dozen paces away. The giant slammed forward into the snow, motionless, pink brain tissue exposed in its huge, knobby skull.
God help us,
Andre said. Valentine reloaded, stepped forward and put two more bullets into the giant's ruined head. He looked about, noting the smashed corpses that had been the two senior sergeants.
Are you hurt?
He yelled over the howling winds, looking from Andre to Dominica. Both shook their heads. Valentine, his muscles trembling from the adrenaline dump, glared at the dead monster.
Giants? Elves. Trolls. And four-armed fishmen weren't bad enough. Now we have to fight giants.
More! Dominica screamed, pointing forward. Two more giants, one of them female, Valentine judged by the heavy swinging breasts, shambled out of the blowing snow, their angry glares taking in the corpse of the first monster, then the two men and women.
Run!
Valentine yelled as he emptied his entire magazine in one long burst. He sprinted after the other two just as something flew past him, a boulder as large as a tire. The rock hit Andre, rolling over him and leaving a red smear on the dirty snow. Valentine dropped his empty rifle, fumbled for a smoke grenade, popped it, and let it fall behind him. Thick yellow smoke filled the air in moments. The giants roared, their footsteps shaking the snow-covered ground. Dominica slipped and fell, and Valentine caught up to her, grabbing her arms and yanking her back onto her feet.
We can't outrun giants.
An engine roared as Leo's scout car charged forward. Valentine pulled Dominica to the side just as the armored car sped past, slamming into the two giants. The vehicle skidded to a halt in the snow. One giant, the female, was dead. cut in half by the knife-like edge of the hull. The other rolled in the snow, still alive. Valentine stepped in front of Dominica, drawing his pistol. The giant rose, saw them, and tensed to charge. Fire blossomed as the armored car's 14.5mm heavy machine gun opened fire, ripping the giant apart from only a few feet away. The roar of the gun so loud that Valentine and Dominica fell back, covering their ears from the onslaught. The giant's shredded carcass fell away in pieces, spraying blood over the gray snow. Valentine screamed in pain, deafened. The crew commander's hatch flew up and young Ilution stepped out, an assault rifle in his hands. He scampered down, then swung about, trying to see in all directions at once before running over to Valentine, Ilution's lips moving in silence.
What?
Valentine yelled. Dominica grabbed his head, placing her hands over his ears, and warmth spread through his head as she healed him.
Are you okay, Major?
The young private asked once more. Valentine steadied himself with a hand on the man's shoulder.
Thanks to you, Ilution. Thanks to you.
They climbed into the armored car and Valentine sat in the turret as Ilution drove. The chain-wrapped tires bit into the snow, edging them forward toward the shimmering light. But before they had gone 100 meters, Valentine ordered the young man to stop. He stared ahead in confusion. There was no tunnel. A vast rip in the fabric of reality. The source of the light floated where the cliff and tunnel had once been. The tear in the air extended for hundreds of meters in all directions. The road led straight to the phenomenon, as if God had engineered it that way, revealing another world on the other side, one with a clear blue sky over a thick forest. Balls of red chain lightning arced all around the distortion. They were trapped. Behind them, Mount Achinsky detonated with a ground-shaking roar. Part 1. Remnants of Hate. 1. Northern British Columbia, 6 years after the Culling. Alex Benoit lay motionless in his hide, a one-foot-deep trench covered by a thermal shield tarp and fresh foliage, and peered through the 2-inch slit at the kill zone 100 meters to his front. 2 rifles sat within reach. A 5.56mm Special Operations Forces Combat Assault Rifle Light, a SCAR-L, and a new Dart X-caliber air rifle. Also close was the Klecker, resembling but far deadlier than an oversized industrial-strength stapler. Something with far too many legs crawled over the back of his hand, but he ignored the urge to brush it away, just as he had countless other times in countless other tactical hides throughout his life. He and the other Rangers had set the ambush up late last night and had been lying nearly motionless for hours. It had been drizzling for some time now and would probably continue for hours yet, but the sky was turning gray with the coming dawn. He switched off his miniaturized night vision goggles, pushed them atop his forehead, and let his eyes adjust to the dim. Even the best night vision technology created a tunnel vision effect and made shooting difficult. As he scanned the terrain ahead of him, he absentmindedly rubbed his short beard. Their kill zone was a 50-meter length of what had once been Beatty Drive in Hudson's Hope, the main drag of the little northern British Columbia town. But the road was barely recognizable now. Vines and weeds choked the rusted-out remains of abandoned cars. New growth, even small trees, had ripped their way through the asphalt, and years of winter freeze, a long broken water main and neglect, had completed the destruction. The wilderness had reclaimed Hudson's Hope almost entirely. Thick vines, grasping weeds, and sprouting trees grew over, under, and through the buildings, breaking glass and ripping apart walls, letting in the rain, which wreaked further havoc, causing most of the homes to sink back into the earth, leaving little behind but broken shells, now overgrown by brush. One building remained intact, though. At the far left of the kill zone sat the Hunter's Inn and Minimart, a brown brick complex housing motel dwellings, a small grocery store, and a sporting goods shop that had once sold hunting supplies, preserved food in cans, warm clothing, sleeping bags, tools, and most importantly for the remnants, guns and ammo. There had always been a surplus of hunting rifles in northern British Columbia, even after the Dark Elf massacre of Fort St. John. Without people, those weapons now sat rusting. The remnants might have been monsters, but they weren't stupid, especially the Dark Elves. They understood all too well what happened when swords and spears went up against firearms. For reasons no one knew, the remnants had stayed in the north rather than moving south, where the temperature was far more survivable. In the last 6 years, they had learned how to survive. But to keep surviving, they needed the weapons, ammo, and supplies in that building, setting them up perfectly for an ambush. As if by magic, a lion appeared on the street, right within Alex's arc of fire. It stepped out from between two abandoned cars, its head held high as it sniffed the cold northern air. Alex held his breath as the lion, a female, he thought, turned to stare at him, its yellow eyes flashing in the pre-dawn light. Male or female, it had to weigh hundreds of pounds of raw muscle. Another lion joined the first, another female, then two more, all moving with remarkable grace. There was a pride in the area, he knew, at least a dozen adults with twice as many young, but the rangers rarely saw them this closely. As with the remnants, he didn't know why they hadn't migrated farther south, but he was glad he had left Larry, Curly, and Moe with the vehicles. The dogs were too loyal and brave for their own good sometimes. The first lioness was still staring at him. Sweat rolled down Alex's face as his fingers drifted closer to the scar L. But the lioness looked away, her nose lowered to the ground. It was entirely possible she knew he and the others were watching them and just didn't care. In a world without people, the lions were near the top of the food chain. And then all four lionesses froze, their posture stiffening, their heads held high. After several seconds, they turned and bolted into the wilderness. Lions still feared something after all. Hellhounds. The earpiece in his ANPRC-148 multiband inter-intra-team radio, his M-biter, chirped once. He knew in a moment it was Dallas, tasked with the right flank security. As expected, the remnants were coming from the east, from the Peace River. Four more clicks followed as Sammy, Henry, Anji, and Becca, each lying in their own hide on either side of Alex, acknowledged Dallas's warning. The Sanchez brothers, Royce and Gracie, the support group who were hiding in the second floor remains of a still-standing church across the street from the Hunter's Inn and on the far end of the L-shaped ambush, clicked twice to indicate they were ready to go hot with the light machine gun. Alex activated his transmit button three times, the agreed-upon code for shit's about to get real. No one would speak, not even a whisper over the radio. They were expecting a remnant scavenging party, probably only boggarts and hellhounds, maybe a troll. But there might be dark elves leading them, and the elves could hear a mouse fart from 100 feet away. He picked up the air rifle and opened the chamber for the CO2 tank, threading it onto the O-ring until he heard the hiss of charging air priming the weapon. Then he slid the dart into the ammunition chamber within the stock and rotated it back into place, readying it for firing. A lifetime ago, he had used a rifle like this to capture a basilisk. He was too old to do stupid shit like that anymore. Alex took aim down the weapon's scope as the enemy moved into sight from the right. A pack of four hellhounds strode down the street, heading toward the Hunter's Inn. He set his crosshairs on the last of the monsters, an obscene cross between a hyena and a wolf, the size of a small pony. Adrenaline surged through his blood, increasing his heart rate. Alex hated hellhounds. They were bad enough without the fire-breathing shit. All four beasts padded past, sniffing the air. He inhaled and exhaled slowly, letting the crosshairs rise and fall on the animal's furry rear quarters, near the long black tail. He needed to put the dart somewhere the beast couldn't reach it, or others couldn't see it. And Alex doubted anything, especially an elf, wanted to look at a hellhound's butt. He squeezed the trigger and the weapon jerked. The hellhound yelped in pain, leaping into the air and spinning about, snapping at the closest beast. It snapped back, snarling, but they separated, choosing not to fight. The shot had been good. The barbed tip on the dart should keep it in place. If not, they had wasted all this time and effort. Well, mused Alex, not a complete waste, if we get to kill remnants. He set the air rifle down and picked up the clacker. The four hellhounds moved farther down the street, out of the kill zone. The boggarts appeared next, a dozen of them carrying hunting rifles with their muscular outer arms, while leaving their much smaller inner arms dangling, like aquatic T-Rexes. With their bald black heads and saucer-like fish eyes and gills running down their throats, they looked like the freakish offspring of an H.P. Lovecraft nightmare. Some wore the remains of their leather and chainmail armor, but most now wore thick layers of human clothing, anything that could keep them warm. He wasn't pleased to see they all had hunting rifles. Years ago, only the leaders carried firearms, but those days had passed. Luckily, boggarts had depth perception issues and were lousy shots, but they could always get lucky. Behind the boggarts were two massive tusk-mouthed trolls, each at least 8 feet tall and 500 or 600 pounds of gristle, fat, and muscle. Each troll carried a 3-foot battle axe over its wide shoulders. Troll fingers were far too large to operate human weapons. Alex primed the clacker, waiting for the boggarts to enter the kill zone. The hair on the back of his neck rose and he froze. 3 dark elves trailed the trolls, and one of them was a female. Shit. Not all females were mages, but all the mages were female. His pulse raced and he forced himself to be calm. Even if she was a mage, he was in no danger. Besides, they had Becca. He squeezed the handle on the clacker, sending a 3-volt pulse through the buried firing wire, leading toward the M18A1 Claymore mine facing the kill zone. The mine detonated with a bone-jarring roar, shotgunning hundreds of tiny steel balls in a 60-degree arc that shredded the closest boggarts and one troll. The hellhounds froze in terror. A second later, Gracie and Royce opened fire with a light machine gun. A next-generation weapon firing belt-fed caseless 7.62mm ammunition. From their elevated position, they sent a withering barrage of machine gun fire down the road, walking the tracers over the entire length of the kill zone. Although neither brother had prior military experience, they possessed a natural gift for firearms, notably sniper weapons and machine guns, and sprayed death with practiced ease. As expected, the hellhounds, having been spared the claymore and machine gun fire, bolted away in fear, disappearing into the woods. The brothers kept firing hundreds of rounds in long bursts, the practiced mad minute of a professional ambush. As abruptly as it had started, the firing stopped. The barrel of the machine gun was no doubt red hot by now.
"Lay it on,"
Alex said into his radio. He picked up his assault rifle and began shooting. The others opened fire as well, with heavy but accurate shots into the kill zone, firing in their predetermined arcs at anything that still moved. Alex let them shoot for about a minute before keying his radio once more.
"Cease fire! Cease fire! Watch and shoot! Watch and shoot!"
The gunfire faded away and silence settled over the dawn. Acrid smoke hung in the air over the kill zone. Someone fired on his left. 3 quick shots in rapid succession, then stopped. 2 more shots echoed across the kill zone, this time coming from the right. Alex saw nothing moving within his assigned arcs, only corpses, so he held his fire. He waited an additional 2 minutes. No one fired. He keyed his M-biter.
"Assault team, move now!"
Alex burst out of his hide with his assault rifle already tight in his shoulder and began to walk forward. To his left and right, he heard the rush of movement as the others surged out of their own hides to advance in line with him. One of the troll corpses might have moved, so Alex double-tapped it, sending 2 aimed shots into the center of visible mass. The corpse lay still. On either side of him, the other rangers fired each time with 2 aimed shots. Alex and the others moved forward through the kill zone, stepping over bodies and pieces of bodies, putting aimed shots into the carcasses. The all-too-familiar smell of cordite, blood, and feces was overpowering, and his heart pounded. His breathing rushed. But within less than a minute, they had moved past the kill zone, reaching the predetermined limit of advance, the LOA. They regrouped, kneeling in a circle, weapons facing outward. The rain continued to patter, hissing and turning into steam where it struck the hot barrels of their rifles.
"Sound off!"
Alex called out, kneeling and watching his own arc of fire. One by one, they reported their status. All 5 were with him and uninjured. One at a time, they carried out a quick combat reload. He keyed his radio.
Support team, call it.
His radio chirped in his earpiece, followed by Royce's excited voice.
Fire doggies lit out, jefe,
he said with his thick Spanish accent.
Nothing moving in the casey. I think we got them all. Got a signal? 5x5, hightailing it north, mucho quickly.
Relief coursed through Alex. His glance fell on Becca, a thin young woman in her 30s who looked both out of her element and strangely at peace as she peered over the barrel of her weapon.
Anything?
She closed her eyes and shook her head, her long brown hair tied up tightly in a bun. Clear. Maybe the claymore took her out. The dark elf woman had been a mage. This scavenging mission must have been important to the remnants. Alex shook his head.
Maybe is not gonna cut it. We need a corpse.
He scanned the corpses on the road. Becca's sense of magic use was spot on. Not as good as Cassie's, but she hadn't let them down yet.
Okay, we'll do one sweep, then light out. Do we have time?
Asked Henry, his voice tight.
If there are more.
We're making the time.
Henry swallowed but nodded. Henry Hill was a big, tough man, a 6'2", 200-plus-pound brute. With his good looks, rugged features, and squinting gray eyes, he looked like a movie star action hero from an old cowboy movie. But despite appearances, he was also the least experienced fighter on the team. Before the Culling, he had been an accountant. Probably a good one. Henry was meticulous. Now he was a fair ranger, if a touch nervous. But nervous kept you alive in the north.
One sweep, people,
Alex repeated as he rose. The others surged out in line again, facing the kill zone once more. They moved forward more cautiously this time, no one firing, but scanning the still smoking carnage. Many of the corpses were missing limbs or heads. Others had gaping holes in their torsos. The dead faces all looked mildly surprised. His eyes took in one of the dark elves, a male. A bullet, probably from the light machine gun, had shattered his head, and the elf's golden eyes bulged on either part of the wound, his long white hair glistening darkly with blood and brain matter.
Hey, boss,
Dallas called out.
We got a live one here.
Alex joined the diminutive Asian American who stood guard over a wounded boggart warrior. Michael Dallas Lee had been a former cook in the U.S. Army and a member of the task force quarantining the dark elf incursion in the Sonoran Desert just before the Culling, finding shelter within its null zone, the 200-kilometer safe zone around the dark elf free transmission towers. Dallas was the second in command of the Doig River Ranger team. Unlike Henry, Dallas was a small man, quick to crack a joke but as hard as nails, and as tough as any Tier 1 Special Forces operator whom Alex had served with. Alex joined him, surprised to see a survivor. Then he realized this one would not make it. The fish-faced warrior sat back against the rusted side of a Dodge Caravan, arterial blood spurting from the stump of one of his, its, inner arms, growing from the center of its torso and the chest wound just beside it, soaking the blue-down hunter's vest and a thick wool sweater. The boggart watched Alex with its bulbous black eyes, each the size of a baseball. Its wide fish mouth filled with double rows of pointy teeth opened and closed, bloody spit bubbles popping as it tried to speak.
Lung must be pierced, Dallas said. Are there lungs in the same place as ours? Do they even have lungs? They have lungs, but much bigger than ours.
Alex slung his rifle on his shoulder and drew his short sword, Witchbane, from the black leather sheath Leela had made him that he wore on his belt. He dropped on one knee, positioning his sword point over the boggart's main heart, just between the two smaller ones. The boggart redoubled its effort to speak, this time succeeding. Its voice, almost a whisper, was a sibilant hiss. Its remaining inner arm jerked. Alex answered the boggart in Empire Common, the language spoken by all creatures within the Faceli Empire. Then he drove the short sword into the boggart's heart, killing it. As he cleaned his blade on the boggart's vest, Dallas looked away and spat chewing tobacco on the ground.
Creeps me out when you talk to them.
Sammy joined them. Sammy was a native, a member of the Dane Za beaver people. He and his cousin Anji were the only two members of the team who had been rangers before the Culling, having been members of the 4th Ranger Patrol Group. Sammy had been one of the few survivors from the Battle of Taylor Bridge.
What did he say?
Alex let his blade hang by his leg.
Same thing they all say. Please don't.
Hey, boss, Becca called out. I count 2 dead elves, both male. Alex saw Becca standing over another dark elf corpse. A chill ran through him. Even from where he stood, he saw the dead elf was male, a warrior with a shotgun and a long, curved saber on his hip. His gaze swept the other corpses.
Nice sharp, people. We're missing a female.
The others dropped to a knee, aiming in all directions. Alex decided in a moment.
Screw the sweep. We're moving now.
He took only 2 steps when Witchbane's red metal blade pulsed and glowed crimson. Then the air before him shimmered and a dark elf woman, the missing mage, appeared out of thin air, her invisibility spell vanishing. The dark elf woman's yellow eyes widened in surprise and she stepped back, thrusting a hand at Alex. Channeling! Becca yelled from behind him at the same moment that the dark elf cast a torrent of fire, like a flamethrower. The flames enveloped him, and for a single heart-stopping moment, he feared he'd burn. But as always, the flames evaporated into sparks instead. The rest of the spell, however, roared past him, and Becca screamed in torment. He slammed into the mage, ramming Witchbane into her stomach with both hands, puncturing the rings of the black chainmail armor she wore and impaling her. Her golden eyes opened wide and she coughed blood into Alex's face. He yanked up the blade and sawed through her from stomach to sternum. Her blood splashed over his vest and hands and she fell dead. He turned to see Becca, wreathed in flames, spinning and flailing at the air, just before Dallas rammed into her with his shoulder, knocking her down. He and Sammy rolled her in the wet ground, beating at the flames with their hands while Becca screamed. Alex joined them as they beat out the fire. Her hair was gone, flash burned away, as was much of her skin, leaving red, weeping sores. Sadly, they were all too familiar with these types of wounds. They undid her clothing, searching for jewelry to remove before her skin bloated, but Becca was no fool and wore none. Her breathing became wet and raspy, her moans pitiful. Alex injected her with 2 ampules of morphine and placed a wet gauze wrap over her face, leaving her burned mouth exposed so she could breathe.
Oh, hell, said Sammy, stepping back. This is bad.
I know, said Alex, sitting back on his heels and considering what to do next.
What are the chances?
Asked Henry from nearby, anguish in his voice.
What are the fucking chances? The only Madge sends in the north.
No, she's not.
Alex snapped.
Pull yourself together.
Anji joined them, kneeling beside her friend and holding her burned hand. She looked at Alex, her glasses reflecting in the still burning fires. What do I do?
Just be with her. Let her hear your voice.
Royce and Gracie skidded to a halt on their hybrid electric motorcycles, the only sound coming from the drive chains and stones crunching beneath their tires. Royce had slung the light machine gun over his back and he kicked up the stand before jumping off and running over to Alex.
Damn, Yiffy. What happened?
Mage. She survived the ambush and turned invisible.
Pure luck I wandered into her when I did. Otherwise, she might have had us all.
All but you,
said Dallas, which was true enough, if a bit cold. Gracie swore, staring at Becca, his dark Hispanic skin blending with the dim light, making his eyes shine. The brothers were so alike, they could have been twins. But Gracie was 2 years older. Good-looking, athletic, and quick to smile, the brothers were the youngest members of the Ranger team, although Becca, in her early 30s, wasn't that much older. Gracie's gaze went from Becca to Anji, who was holding her hand and cradling her head, whispering to her.
God damn it.
Becca and Anji couldn't have been more different. Anji was a native, an experienced hunter, and an old hand at living rough off the land. But Becca was white, an Anglo-Saxon Protestant, and had worked in a nail salon in Fort St. John, rarely camping for more than a weekend. Maybe it was their shared hatred of the remnants, or maybe it was because they were the only women on the team, but they had become close. Anji looked up, cradling Becca's head against her chest, anguish in her eyes.
Please, Alex. Henry joined them, a lit cigarette dangling from his lips.
What do you want to do, boss?
Alex yanked the cigarette from the man's lips, tossed it on the ground, then dragged Henry to the motorcycles. He flicked the switch on the motorcycle, engaging the much louder but more powerful gasoline engine, which rumbled throatily. Gracie engaged his engine as well.
You three, get to the vehicles,
Alex said to Henry and the Sanchez brothers.
Bring them back as fast as you can.
Henry waited until Royce had climbed back onto his bike, then straddled him from behind, grabbing him around the waist.
What are you gonna do?
Dallas asked as Gracie gunned the engine.
Send Paco a nine-liner.
As the two motorcycles sped off, maneuvering around the abandoned cars and broken asphalt, Alex pulled the satellite phone from his tactical vest. 2. Wild Spike Island, Ferrum. Queen Tuatha de Talinor stood upon the battlements of her star tower, staring out over the roiling green sea. 4 of her storm guard warriors, elite Fae Seelie women, maintained a silent guard behind her in their black and silver plate mail armor and helmets. White crested waves crashed against the knife like rocks hundreds of feet below, sending cold spray and mist into the air, causing her to shiver despite the thick griffin fur lined cloak she wore. Even the wind bit at her exposed face, her flawless purple skin. Of all her fortresses, she hated this one the most. But Wild Spike Island, sitting off the coast of the southeastern shoreline, was the most secure in her empire. And in the aftermath of the sundering, she needed security more than comfort. Do I even still have an empire? And if so, will I have one a month from now? Her enemies had always been many, but with the bulk of her army stuck on the old world, they had grown bold. Tuatha could fix this. She was the most powerful mage master who had ever lived. What she couldn't do was fix the culling machine, and without its magic, she'd grow old and die. Damn Horlastia to the red ether. She shivered, perhaps from the chill, perhaps from the specter of her own death, and pulled the edges of her cloak in closer around her thin shoulders. Tuatha felt the verm's presence moments before she heard the beating of its mighty wings and the rush of wind as it dropped like a thunderbolt onto the summit of her tower, shaking the stone foundations. She spun about, filling herself with magic even though it was pointless. No living creature could fight a great dragon. How had it appeared out of thin air? Had it been waiting for her to stand upon her tower summit, vulnerable? Tuatha didn't recognize this verm, but the monsters guarded their secrecy, and the only great dragon she had ever spoken to was Balefire. This one, while smaller than Balefire, was equally formidable. It was larger than any other living thing on Ferrum, with a wingspan at least 100 feet across. Its scales were bright silver, flashing in the setting sun. Its neck, long and powerful. Its head, crowned by 4 horns. 2 large spiraling ones on either side of the serpentine head, with 2 little more than nubs beneath them. To their credit and breathtaking stupidity, her storm guard warriors rushed at the verm, actually thinking to attack it with their 2-handed swords. With 1 sweep of a wing, the verm sent them all hurtling over the side of the tower, leaving Tuatha alone to face it. When the dragon spoke, its words thundered in her skull.
Cast that spell, elfin queen, and I shall feast upon your tender flesh. I am here to speak, not kill.
Tuatha, fear clawing through her, released the magic. She lowered her head in respect.
Welcome, then, great one. How may I be of service?
By dispensing with the pleasantries. How did Balefire pass from life to death?
Death. Balefire is dead?
It seemed impossible, but she realized it must be so. The only way the manlings could have destroyed the culling machine, unleashing the sundering upon her empire, was to defeat the dragon guarding it first. But how? No one bested a great dragon. It was unthinkable, akin to imagining the sun not setting. She stalled, her heart pounding.
Great one, to whom do I have the honor of speaking?
Names are power, elfling queen. unlike my brother, Balefire, I have no desire to share with you. Answer my question.
Great one. I do not know what has befallen Balefire. All I know is that my empire crumbles. This was truth. Even her own kin betrayed her, and recent reports stated that the heretical followers of the benevolent grandfather were now in the open, advocating love and forgiveness. How did it fall apart so quickly?
Speak of the compact between you and Balefire.
He crossed the red ether to the old world, the world of manlings. Once there, he agreed to defeat the manlings for me. In return, I was to gift him the Shetker orb.
And the orb, where is it now?
Destroyed. All three orbs were destroyed, along with the dwarven culling machine. The sundering. The dragon's crimson eyes flashed with fire.
What have you done? Never before has anyone abused the red ether so carelessly. Even now, the reverberations of your stupidity ripple across the cosmos, opening doors where they shouldn't be. Where it will end, even we cannot say.
It wasn't me. It was the manlings.
Manlings? Impossible. Those primitives hide in caves, huddling around campfires. They couldn't defeat a hero such as Balefire.
Not true, Great One. They have evolved and multiplied. They have powerful weapons, weapons that can kill even The dragon's wings snapped out to the side, the buffeting winds knocking Tuatha to her knees. Its head rose high on its long neck. A trace of blue fires jutted angrily from its nostrils.
Fool of an elfling. You have damaged the fabric of existence, and for what? A fraction more of your pitifully short life. You aren't worth the effort.
The dragon took to the air. Tuatha awoke, bolting upright in her bedchamber as the door opened. A servant entered, holding a lit candle.
Apologies, Your Majesty.
As protective as always, Riz Logan, her spider-demon familiar, scuttled closer to the open doorway, and the servant's eyes widened with terror. A layer of sweat coated Tuatha's skin, and she could barely breathe with her racing heartbeat. Her small fingers massaged her chest through her thin shift. For 6 cycles now, nightmares of that foul verm haunted her sleep. She hated that dragon more than anything. She held one hand out to the servant and closed her eyes, trying to find calm and peace. When her heart stopped racing, she spoke.
What?
What is it?
A messenger from the High Mage Elder. She thinks another rupture might be forming.
Where?
A lady or haven, Majesty.
Send for my advisors. We'll meet at once. As Tuatha strolled into her council chambers, her advisors leapt to their feet, their hands across their chests, bowing deeply. Riz Logan scurried along behind her. Standing around the massive oak table were Kondrasia Halfheart, the one-eared, heavily scarred veteran mage warden who served as commander of her elite storm guard, Cal and Dralia, a mage scout and her elderly spymaster, and Ruth Balmorin, a diminutive, mouse-faced woman who was the new High Mage Elder. Also in attendance were a handful of Fae-Seelie nobles from those great houses that had remained loyal, but their presence was more a formality than a necessity. More often than not, their counsel was worth less than a redcap's courage. Cal Andralia rose much more slowly than the others and leaned upon her Etten Bone walking cane.
"My queen,"
the spymaster said in a voice like brittle paper.
"The reports are less than desirable."
Her skin was so old and lined that it had long ago faded from its natural deep purple to a pale blue, but the spymaster's mind remained sharper than a fell cat's claws. And age was a foolish weight by which to judge someone's worth. Tuatha herself was much, much older than Cal Andralia, kept that way by stolen life forces, but not for much longer, not without the culling machine. All things ended, even her life.
"Damn you, Horlastia. Daughter, I trusted you with my armies, with everything. I pray to the Spider Mother every night you died screaming for your failure."
When are reports at this late an hour ever desirable? Tuatha asked as she seated herself at the head of the table. She motioned for the others to sit, and they did so with a squeaking of wooden chair legs. So tell me. Ruth Balmoran coughed once to clear her throat. Another rupture. A gift from within the red ether is forming, my queen. Near the ley lines that form the Nexus Star, on the plains of Eladior Haven.
I see, she said, her thoughts a seething tempest. And the other end?
Near the city the Manlings call Fort St. John.
Fort St. John. Her heart rate quickened. Where my foolish daughter Horlastia had deployed the Culling machine. It was also the epicenter of the Sundering.
6 cycles ago, Horlastia commanded the largest military force that Tuatha sent to the Old World. Over 30,000 boggarts, trolls, and loyal Fae Seelie warriors. If Tuatha could recover that army. Her eyes drifted over those of her advisors, who were waiting for her to speak.
Do my daughters know of the disturbance?
Well, that is. The High Mage Elder's eyes told Tuatha what she needed to know.
Yes.
Yes, my queen. Calandrelia confirmed. She was one of the few who weren't too frightened to give Tuatha unwelcome news. The twins have already deployed their forces around it, awaiting its opening.
Tuatha sighed. Well, it was too much to hope they'd be too stupid or naive to sense what's coming. They may be traitors, but they share my blood, however diluted by their freakish nature.
Brush them aside, my queen, insisted Kondrasia Halfheart. Give me the honor.
I need you here, my general, to protect us.
She raised an eyebrow and cocked her head at Calandralia.
But what of the army? I will need to deal with the twins eventually.
The Crown Princess has sent a messenger bat, her storm guard commander said. She reports she can maintain the siege of House Galthazen with a small part of her forces, while moving the bulk of the army south to crush her sisters. She begs the honor of cleansing the de Talinor name. Tuatha glanced at Calandralia, who gave an almost imperceptible shake of her head.
Leave me with my spymaster, Tuatha ordered. All of you, get out!
They rushed out, veering away from where Riz Logan groomed one of his long, spiky-haired legs. When they were alone and the door to the council chamber had closed, Tuatha turned to her spymaster.
Well?
Wolf reports it would be a disaster, my queen. He insists the siege will fail if any part of the army moves away, and even if they force march the entire army to a lady or a haven within the next few days, they'd arrive strung out and in poor shape to fight the twin soldiers. Besides, he promises House Galthazen will fall if your commitment remains firm. The Crown Princess is a tad optimistic in her abilities.
Meaning the little fool has no clue what she's doing?
Wolf does, and he and his warriors serve us well. Tuatha sat back, sighing and rubbing her face with her hands.
So, even if I wanted to, there's no way to reach Eladior Haven with enough force to defeat my daughters. And if I try, I'll lose my chance to finish off House Galthazen?
So it would seem, my queen.
The spymaster hesitated, clearly wishing to say something further. What?
Tuatha demanded. I have my best mage scout near Eladior Haven, my queen.
The one nicknamed Silent Death?
The same, Majesty. Trilisandia. She reports she has seen the Verm near the city. The Silver One.
Tuatha stared at her spymaster, a chill running down her spine. That damn monster plagues me, awake or asleep. I see. Do you know why?
Calandralia shook her head, unable to meet Tuatha's eyes. Just the obvious guess, but the magic in the air has attracted its attention, my queen. They are in tune with such things.
Tuatha seethed. It infuriated her that a mage master as powerful as she was needed to fear anything, even a dragon. Your advice, old friend? She asked, eager to change the subject.
Let the twins have this. It may prove useless to them anyhow.
The sundering must have done as much damage to this Fort St. John as it did to a lady or haven. Nothing may remain of Horlastia's army to bring home.
Yes, said Tuatha, rising. Send word to Crown Princess Caledania. She is to maintain the siege of House Galthazin. Under no condition is she to move any forces to a lady or haven. Fly the same message to Wolf to make sure.
Yes, my queen. A wise decision.
No. A bitter one, but necessary. After I've skinned Matron Feldrassia and her daughters and House Galthazian is nothing more than a memory, I will bring a reckoning to the twins.
My queen. Calandralia said, bowing her head. Tuatha strode from the chamber, Rizlogan on her heels. She wanted to find sleep once more tonight, hoping that for once she might dream of something other than that foul dragon.
3. Alex paced the hilltop, watching the eastern sky for the bird. The rain had stopped and the clouds parted to show a crimson dawn. They had driven here at breakneck speed, taking just over 30 minutes, but in that time Becca's breathing had worsened as her lungs filled with fluid. Alex opened and closed his fingers, making tight fists.
Come on, Paco. Hurry, brother.
Mo, standing next to his leg, whined and rubbed the top of his large head against Alex's hand. Alex absent-mindedly scratched behind the dog's ears. Mo's brothers, Larry and Curly, were nearby, lying on their bellies and watching the surrounding forest. The three dogs were mongrels, a dark-colored mix of husky, sheepdog, and likely wolf. They were so self-reliant that they were almost wild, like most dogs these days. Yet Mo, the smallest, had bonded with Alex. The animals had adopted the ranger team over a year ago, becoming integral to their patrols. Dark elf mages could turn invisible, but they couldn't mask their scent. The two Oshkosh all-terrain vehicles, looking like something out of a Mad Max movie, sat on either side of the hill, facing outward. He and the other rangers had found the vehicles, originally intended as prototypes for the Canadian Army, locked in a warehouse in the now-empty base in Edmonton, along with the motorcycles and more ammo and equipment than they could ever use. Roy sat in the rear of one vehicle, operating its remote turret-mounted 30mm chain gun, while his brother was in the other, with the grenade launcher. Both vehicles pulled a trailer, with one holding both Silent Hawk motorcycles and the other gasoline, water, and other essential supplies. The vehicles, armored with bullet-resistant glass, were painted in a dark green camouflage pattern to blend with the northern forests. They were fireproof, air-conditioned, and over-pressured to keep those inside protected from fireballs or lightning bolts. Alex didn't expect to run into any more remnants, but in this world, you were careful or dead. Nearby, Angie sat beside Becca, holding an IV bag over the injured woman. They had strapped her to a collapsible stretcher, securing her limbs to stop her from hurting herself. But they needn't have bothered. She was barely moving. When Alex heard the far-off thump of rotor blades, he popped a purple smoke grenade and tossed it near the hill's summit.
Thank you, God.
The sound of rotors increased, then, with little warning, a dark green CH-146 Griffin helicopter appeared over the trees, flying at a dangerously low altitude. The pilot, assigned by McKnight's staff to the airhead at Doig River, knew his business and set the aircraft atop the hill with practiced ease, blowing the purple smoke away in the prop wash. Two men in flight suits and aircrew helmets shoved the side doors open before jumping out, each with a medical bag and an M4 carbine. A woman climbed out next, wearing blue jeans and a plaid shirt. Unlike the men, she carried nothing. Her long brown hair flapped about, obscuring her face, but Alex would have recognized her anywhere. He froze, his throat clenched shut. He didn't know why he was surprised to see her. She was the reason he had called his brother-in-law for the medevac. It was just difficult to face his wife after so long. After everything between them. Leela stared at him, looking tired but healthy. The medics bolted past to tend to Becca. Leela moved closer to Alex, her expression unreadable.
Are you okay?
She yelled over the engine.
Are you hurt?
He shook his head.
It's Becca. She's been burned.
He pointed to the stretcher where the medics were already tending to the injured woman. Leela dodged past him to kneel at Becca's side, her hands gliding over the woman's burned face. Angie and the two medics moved away, waiting. Alex was about to join them when Dallas gripped his arm and pulled him back. When Alex stared in confusion, the other man glanced down at Witchbane's hilt, where it sat belted to Alex's waist. He nodded and drew the short sword, then handed it to Dallas. In the light of sunrise, its already crimson blade looked drenched in blood. He caught up to his wife just as she was standing.
"That's all I can do now," she yelled. "We need to get her to the infirmary. There's a remote medical setup we can hook her to, and we'll let Dr. Ireland examine her."
"She gonna make it?"
Alex asked. Leela wasn't a gifted healer, and Becca looked much the same. Bad.
"Maybe. I need Cassie's help."
"We got a motor,"
one medic said, glancing at the woods.
"Too vulnerable out here." "Do what you have to do,"
Alex yelled, getting out of the way as the medics lifted Becca and carried her to the helicopter. Leela walked alongside Becca, her hand on the other woman's arm.
"You coming?"
she asked Alex, studiously avoiding his gaze as the medics secured the stretcher inside the helicopter.
"Later,"
Alex called.
"We'll catch up. Have to check something first."
His wife climbed aboard the Griffin and the side door slammed shut. Alex stepped back as the aircraft lifted, turned sharply and sped away toward the Doig River settlement. Dallas joined him, handing him a short sword.
"You okay, boss?"
"What?"
"Yeah, fine."
"You two talk?"
"Show me the tracking data. I need to see that this wasn't for nothing."
"Here,"
said Gracie, stabbing a thick finger at the digital map on the handheld computer pad, showing Alex the location of the dart with which he had shot the hellhound.
"Be thankful the satellites are still circling the planet, so we can track GPS.
The others, Royce, Dallas, Henry, Sammy, and Angie, stood in a circle about them, trying to look over Alex's shoulder.
"For now,"
said Dallas with a frown.
"Soon those things will start falling out of the sky, especially if there's no one interacting with them." "Now is what we need,"
said Alex, tracing the river on the screen with his index finger.
"This is the halfway river, isn't it?"
"I told you it'd be the halfway,"
said Royce, punching his brother in the biceps.
"This bend in the river is perfect for winter camp, as snug as bugs in a rug."
"About 16 clicks northeast of Hudson's Hope,"
said Dallas.
"Friggin' hellhounds can haul ass, if that is their camp."
"It is,"
Alex said with certainty.
"I feel it in my bones."
Dallas lit a cigarette, then blew out a cloud of smoke.
"Your bones say anything about those thick woods we're gonna have to sneak through to get there?"
Angie took the cigarette from his mouth and inhaled a drag.
"We're rangers. Sneaking through woods is what we do."
"Not as well as elves,"
said Henry, looking at the others.
"We should make sure before we move on them.
I'm telling you, we need UAVs. Hunting dark elves in the forest on foot is insane."
"Well, hell, Henry,"
snapped Alex.
"That's the job you signed on for, isn't it?"
"Okay, okay,"
Dallas said, stepping between them.
"How do we play this, boss?"
"First, we check on Becca and rearm. We can figure it out from there. Let's head home and regroup."
"There's something else, boss. Auntie didn't want to say anything before, but she was already worried about Becca. I checked your ruck and found these."
Dallas held his palm out, showing a small pill case half filled with red and green capsules.
"What are they?"
"Dunno. Uppers, downers, not a clue. She's been distracted lately."
Alex sighed.
"How did I miss this? Some leader you are. Figured she'd just miss the mage, but maybe there was more to it."
"Maybe we're all, well, you know."
"I know. Let's get going."
It was just under a 150-kilometer drive to Doig River. In the old days, they'd have made the trip in 2 hours. But now, with storm-blown fallen trees and weather-ruptured asphalt, they took 4 hours along the one-time Alaska highway before they turned east onto a secondary road, and the bend in the Doig River where the settlement sat. The entire way they saw no one, but that was unsurprising. While the post Culling north overflowed with birds and wildlife, humanity had all but vanished. There were still people living up here on isolated homesteads, those who had been protected by the null zone over the Culling machine in Fort St. John, before Elizabeth had destroyed it, sacrificing her own life to do so. But these days, you really had to make the effort to find them.
Humanity. Blink and you'll miss it.
Alex and his team knew where each of the remaining dozen or so homesteads was located. They visited them as often as they could while on patrol. Mostly, they were older couples, those with too much time tied up in the land to resettle in Boulder City or even Doig River. Surprisingly, the settlers were safe enough living alone in the wilderness. Other than the odd hellhound attack, the remnant forces avoided people. Alex couldn't guess why, but he didn't need to understand them to kill them. By the time they reached the settlement, it was already afternoon. Sammy used the radio to call in their arrival, making sure a nervous sentry didn't shoot at them as they drove up. The sentries pulled the steel-shod gates open, and the two ATVs slowed to a crawl. They hadn't been home in 3 months. Before driving through the gate, Alex stared at the remains of the old settlement beside the riverbank outside the high steel walls. The wilderness had almost completely reclaimed the charred remains of the cabins. But when he saw their old cottage, what was left of it, a weight settled on his heart. Unable to cope, he forced his grief deep within him. He had things to do right now. But he'd visit Noah later. 4. Alex left the others at the ranger compound and walked through the settlement, heading for the infirmary, his emotions still surging from seeing Leela again. Mo silently padded alongside him. Alex had left his gear and weapons, especially Witchbane, with the vehicles, but he wore a 9mm pistol on his hip. It felt weird without the constant weight of his weapons, as if he were naked, but the sword would interfere with Leela's magic. Besides, he didn't need the firepower behind the corrugated steel walls surrounding the settlement. For better or for worse, this was home. Home. The burned-out remains of the small cottage that had been his true home flashed in his memory, but he forced his thoughts away, examining his surroundings instead. The pain, even months later, was still too fresh. He walked past tightly packed rows of trailers, many of which were now empty and dark. Every time he returned, it seemed there were fewer survivors. He spotted construction, a warehouse made from the same galvanized steel as the town wall, sentry towers, a large water tower, and even a two-story community center built from logs. A few children, teenagers mostly, hung out in front of the center. None of them was younger than 7 or 8. In fact, Alex hadn't seen a single toddler in the settlement. The sickness was spreading.
How long before there's no children at all?
From across the settlement, he heard the whine of a helicopter's turbine coming from the airhead, but the engine cut out a few moments later. The pilots were likely running checks. There was a dirt runway outside the wall, suitable for small planes, but the survivors only maintained it for emergency flights to Boulder City. Up ahead, Alex saw the infirmary, another of the ubiquitous trailers. A black and tan German shepherd, an older fellow, well over 10 years old, was lying at the base of the steps leading to the infirmary door.
Clyde, which means Paco is here.
At their approach, Clyde watched Mo, his large, scruffy ears standing straight. Mo left Alex, padding over to meet the other dog.
Gentle Mo,
Alex said. There was no need. The two dogs walked about in a circle, sniffing each other's butts. Then satisfied, Clyde plopped down again, scattering dirt and dust. Mo lay beside him, his head resting atop Clyde's neck. Alex knelt beside them and scratched behind Clyde's ears.
Hey, old fella,
he whispered.
Long time no smell.
Clyde snorted and licked Alex's hand. Alex rose and climbed the steps, which creaked under his weight. He raised a fist to rap upon the thin aluminum door but stopped himself, suddenly worried about what he'd say to Leela. It was far too late for sorry I didn't call.
Time to man up.
He turned the doorknob and pushed the door open, entering a combination reception room and office filled with a desk, folding chairs, gleaming metal cabinets, and a massive refrigeration unit stocked to bursting with supplies. No one was present. After months in the wilderness, the strong antiseptic smell of cleaning products hit him like a wall. He closed the door behind him and squirted sanitizer from a station beside the door onto his hands, but only smeared the dirt around. He really was filthy. A door opened at the rear of the infirmary, and Paco and a young woman in medical scrubs slipped out. Paco, looking older, grayer, and heavier, nodded at Alex, holding a finger up to him. A former tracker and soldier, he had always been a rugged wilderness type, but he had grown into his position as settlement elder and now looked the part, beaming with self-assurance, streaks of silver in his long hair and beard.
Clyde isn't the only one getting older,
Alex mused. Paco wore blue jeans, a black t-shirt, and a hunting vest. Like Alex, a 9mm pistol sat on his hip. He whispered to the young woman, and she slipped back through the door. As she closed it, Alex glimpsed Becca lying in bed with a tube in her throat. A camera sat before her on a tripod. Paco flashed Alex a grin, came over and gripped him in a too-tight bear hug. He stepped back, holding Alex at arm's length, and scowled.
Damn, brother, you stink. Smelling like soap gets you killed out there.
Paco rested his hips against a stainless steel counter.
Why so long this time? And I hear you've got new blood on the team. Americans? We were busy. And there's no such thing as Americans or Canadians anymore. Haven't you heard? We're all North American Council now. Brave New World, all that shit.
Paco snorted, smiling.
McKnight and those white boys down south can kiss my ass. I'm Daneza, and always will be. McKnight's not a white boy.
He paused, now seeing the lines around his brother-in-law's eyes. The burden of leadership was taking its toll on Paco.
You hanging in there?
Paco grunted.
I'm fine. We had to fly the last child to Cassie 2 days ago. Parents went as well. Soon, there won't be anyone here but old farts like me. Sorry, brother. I knew it was bad, but bad would be an improvement. There's not a child under 6 left on the reserve.
Paco shook his head, a forced chuckle in his throat.
Bad omen for the beaver people. Looks like the creator is finally giving us back the land you white devils stole, just before the end of the world. Cassie'll sort it out, or Cargan, or Ira. Dwarves just seem to get everything intuitively. Biology, biochemistry, electrical and mechanical engineering, and Helena Simmons was always the smartest person in the room, even when there were billions of people on the planet instead of thousands. Trust me, McKnight has a plan for curing the ghost sickness. I pray you're right, brother.
Alex looked past Paco, glancing at the closed door.
Where's Leela?
He asked as nonchalantly as he could.
Sleeping? She's done all she can for Becca. So has our resident nurse from Boulder City. We've hooked her up to the remote patient monitoring gear, and Dr. Ireland, you met her? She's from the hospital in Fort St. John. I know her, a lifetime ago. I don't think she likes me. Smart lady. Anyhow, she feels good that Becca won't go into shock before we can medevac her. Shit. I mean, I'm glad she's gonna make it, but I was hoping Leela could take care of everything here. Leela was never much of a healer. Besides, why does it matter where she's healed? Cassie will have her better than before within 20 seconds of seeing her. No one's ever better than before after almost burning to death. But we're going out again tonight, and I was hoping... No, brother. Becca's going straight for Starlight's personal attention as soon as we can arrange a flight.
Paco's eyes narrowed.
And what's this shit? You just got back in. Besides, what were you doing all the way over in Hudson's Hope? Our job. Bullshit. Your job is to patrol the homesteads and sweep for remnants and wild animals. My job is to keep people safe, which means finding the Dark Elves, and we did it, brother. Took us forever, but we found them. No shit.
Paco leaned back on his elbows against the counter, his eyes alight with interest.
Where? Northeast of Hudson's Hope, hidden away in a loop in the Halfway River. Their main camp? Their last camp. We're guessing 300 to 400 boggarts, a couple of dozen hellhounds, maybe as many trolls, and all the remaining elves. Could be 50 or 60, including any mages they still have. How do you know this? Because I'm good at my job. They've been raiding the abandoned homes along the Peace River and cleaned out Atachi and Farrow Creek a few weeks ago, moving southwest. Hudson's Hope made sense, and we were right. They walked right into our ambush, and we put a tracking dart on a hellhound. The elves are too smart to work a pattern. No choice. After 6 years, there's only so much salvage left. They have to be methodical now.
Paco rubbed his chin, his gaze thoughtful.
I never understood why they stayed there, so close to us, when they could have moved anywhere. Shit, they have the entire continent now. Why not move south, where the air doesn't hurt your face during winter?
Alex shrugged.
Why haven't you moved south? This is our home. We're not going anywhere. I don't know, brother. Maybe they figure if they stay near where they created their interdimensional gateway 6 years ago, someone will come back for them, and they can go home. Maybe I don't give a shit. Maybe they're here, and I'm gonna deal with them.
Paco's gaze turned hard.
Seeing as how you brought it up, you and your team have been busy since you came back from your resup run south a few months back. What of it? We're rangers. We're supposed to be busy. You're supposed to risk burning down the forest, leaving death in your wake?
A chill ran down his back.
Paco, whatever you think. The Glover brothers were over in Goodlow a couple of weeks back, hunting elk. Came across your work, a burned-out remnant camp. Nothing left but ash piles of what used to be boggarts and trolls. What did you use, Willy Pete grenades?
Stay the fuck away from our business, brother. I mean it.
Your business. You're screwing around with incendiary munitions in a world where there's no more fire department or water bombers. That's not your job.
Alex exhaled, a cold layer of sweat forming on his face.
You need to tell the Glover brothers and everyone else to stay away from Goodlow, or anywhere we've been working. I mean it. This is no joke, it's dangerous. No shit, it's dangerous. You and your hard luck gang of elf-hating rangers aren't as clever or as careful as you think. You experts burned the remnant corpses but left the woods filled with dead animals, hundreds of them lying everywhere. What the hell, man?
Alex looked away, a knot in his stomach.
Step back on this one, brother. Let it be. Does McKnight know? McKnight is busy rebuilding civilization. Besides, after tonight it won't matter anymore. You trying to get yourself killed, Alex? You think that'll change what happened? Dude, she needs you.
Alex turned away and ran his fingers over his face, forcing down emotions he couldn't even try to cope with.
She's better off. Alex.
Paco whispered, his voice filled with concern. He reached out a hand toward Alex, but Alex drew back.
You tell her for me. Tell her I'll make 'em pay. She doesn't want that. She never wanted that. That's you.
Silence stretched between them. Finally, Paco broke it.
Okay, fine. If this is how it has to be, let's do it. But not just you guys. That's stupid. McKnight's been bragging about this new formation he's put together from what was left of the 1st Canadian Mechanized Brigade Group and the 82nd Airborne. He says he's got a shit-hot company plus gang of New World ass-kickers that can move fast and hit hard. He's calling them his strike force. Don't look at me like that, man. Sounds stupid, but he swears they're legit. Let me call him on this. They can roll over this remnant camp. Shit, McKnight's got the only air force. Let him napalm their fantasy monster asses from 1,000 meters. You can stroll through after and piss on the embers. Take too long. Even if they were wheels up in the next couple of hours, which you and I both know is bullshit, it's a 3-hour flight. Then it's gonna be another few hours to sort out their shit, conduct a map recce, and begin mission planning. They're not landing on your strip in anything larger than a C-130 Herc. Nothing that can transport an entire company over land. You're gonna have to find vehicles and drivers, then bring them to a stepping-off point. McKnight said Cargan's been working on something special. That they could be here way faster than that. Bullshit. Wishful thinking. Best case scenario. It's gonna take a day for them to get here. Then what?
Hundreds of grunts break in trail through northern wilderness. He laughed bitterly, shaking his head, and moved over to a small window to stare out over the settlement as the sun set. No, I'm right. This is the only way.
Give him a chance,
Paco said.
No one knows the elves like I do. They'll hear this strike force coming from 12 kilometers away.
He was horrified at the thought of that many soldiers stomping through the woods, thinking they were stealthy.
The elves will bolt. Or worse, they'll stay. Turn invisible and set them on fire. No one will even see one. It'll be a massacre. Then what? Maybe now they're angry. Maybe they look toward you and your little walled town. Maybe this time they finish what they started.
Paco, knowing Alex was right, looked away. The silence was thunderous. Outside, an elderly couple, their brown skin creased by time and hard lives, walked past, hand in hand. They disappeared around a trailer.
Is this the future? Just old people? It's my way or no way,
he whispered.
There's something else,
Paco said softly.
And it's going to hurt.
Alex was sitting on the steps to the infirmary with Mo when Dallas found him. Paco and Clyde had left some time ago. Mo lay with his head on Alex's leg, Alex's hand atop the dog's head. Alex watched Dallas approach, thinking how badly he wanted to get drunk, how he needed to bludgeon his soul with alcohol. Once he started drinking, he'd never stop. But the mission came first. Dallas stood beside him.
You okay, boss? Becca's going to Starlight. Just as well. She's not up to this anymore.
Dallas nodded, not asking the obvious aloud.
Are you? Am I?
Far off, an owl hooted, answered a moment later by a loon. The forests were becoming crowded. The wildlife had bounced back from humanity's abrupt departure, especially the birds. Some flocks had grown so large they darkened the sky when flying over. Well, not all the animals had prospered. Roaches nearly vanished in the first winter without humans to keep the heat on, and millions of livestock, cattle, and poultry had starved in pens. He didn't like thinking of the pets, the dogs and cats locked up in homes, waiting for owners who never returned. Some had broken out, though. The house cats turned feral overnight, doing just fine murdering small animals. But the dogs did less well without people, and the small dogs vanished. Natural selection. The only ones to survive had been the dogs large enough to join wolf packs, or those saved by the survivors.
How's the team?
Dallas lit a cigarette.
Henry's being a little bitch about doing things with Becca. Says it's crazy to go without a mag sense. The brothers feel the same way, but they're solid. They'll be fine. Angie wants payback for Becca and Sammy. Well, I don't know about Sammy. He's all smiles, but there's something. Something wrong with that man. Something wrong with all of us.
Dallas wasn't wrong, though. The Battle of Taylor Bridge had changed Sammy. He had lost 4 young cousins during the fighting, likely even a part of himself. If he weren't a ranger, didn't have revenge to keep him going, what would become of him?
What about you, Alex? What are you good for now?
I was thinking, Alex said.
Should I be worried? That I should do this by myself.
You drunk already, boss? Not fair.
It's cool, I'm Trixie.
He paused, smiling at Dallas, who didn't smile back.
Cut me some slack. Unlike you, I wasn't an army cook before the Culling. I'm X-Tier 1 Special Forces. Shit, I earned the nickname Ranger years ago when I topped the U.S. Army Ranger course. Trust me, I can move quieter by myself. Set the timers on the payload, then DD Mal back to the road.
Oh yeah?
Said Dallas, exhaling a cloud of smoke.
That's a great fucking idea. No backup, no fire support. I'm sure nothing'll go wrong.
I'm serious. Alone means less noise. Less chance of discovery.
No, alone means dead. Then we lose everything.
I can always pull rank.
Dallas snorted.
You'd have more luck pulling yourself, Major Benoit. Ranger rank is more of a polite honorific. Hell, I'm a captain.
He chuckled softly.
Captain Lee, Mom would have been proud.
Alex scowled.
We'll talk about it with the others. Get him ready to roll. I'll be back in an hour.
He climbed to his feet and Mo jumped up with him, panting.
What are you doing? I have to say hi to someone.
5. Alex walked out of the walled settlement. The three older men on sentry opened the gate, saying nothing. They probably guessed where he was going. Besides, he was a ranger at home in the wild. Shadow stretched through the trees along the river where the old reservation had been, and Alex strode toward them, leaving behind the ever-present noise of the settlement's many generators. Mo loped along beside him before darting after a particularly brazen squirrel. Dog and prey vanished into the thick foliage. Their cabin was now little more than pieces of charred beams overgrown by vines and bush. He stood, numb all over, staring at the ruins, remembering how it had been. Most of the 36 cabins had been burned that night. Some cabins had survived intact, but the forest reclaimed the abandoned homes, blanketing them in leaves and vines.
Soon, that'll be us.
Mo ran back, panting from his chase, and Alex moved through the ruins and came out upon the grassy bank of the river. The setting sun glinted on the surface of the Doig River, glistening red and gold, and a fish leaped from the water then splashed back again. Noah had played here for hours, with Leela sitting in a chair nearby, reading a book or levitating a toy for the boys' excited squeals. Alex stood breathless, staring at the small fenced plot and the even smaller wooden cross bearing his son's name. His heart shuddered with loss, and he fell to his knees before the grave. Mo sat beside him, placing his large head in Alex's lap. Alex trailed his fingers through the dog's fur.
Hello, Noah, he whispered.
Alex remained there for a while. He didn't know how long, talking softly with his son. He didn't hear Leela arriving so much as he felt her presence. She wasn't trying to sneak up on him. It was just that she had grown up in the wild and was a far better woodsman than he'd ever be. She came around the burned cabin wearing a plaid shirt, blue jeans, and a burgundy hoodie. Their eyes met and she stood there, saying nothing. Almost a ghost. Alex turned his gaze back to his son's grave.
Noah loved it here, but it's so quiet now.
He's not there, Alex, she said. Now he lives here.
She pointed to her heart.
I carry him with me, as do you. You don't need to come here to talk to him.
I don't know what I need.
She lowered herself beside him, being careful to leave a space between them. Inches and an endless gulf. Mo lifted his head and licked her hand, and the faintest smile curled her lips. She glanced at his face in profile.
You grew a beard.
You don't like it?
She stared ahead over the river.
It's fine.
A loon cried out, its call echoing over the woods. Leela slapped at a mosquito. They stayed like that for a while. Alex eventually spoke, his voice breaking.
Do you believe it?
She didn't answer right away. The silence became so heavy he considered asking again, but she finally spoke.
It makes sense, Alex. They left us alone for so long. We left them alone. I think we went 2 years without even seeing one. Then one night, they attack. Burn the settlement. Seems weird, doesn't it?
They're animals.
Are they? If so, what does that make us?
They didn't need a reason to murder over 7 billion people.
The Dark Elves, not the Buggarts. Cargan told you they were little more than slaves to the Faeseli Empire, to this Queen Tuatha de Talinor. She forced them to come here.
I can't accept that this was our fault.
She reached over and cupped his chin and turned his head so he looked into her large brown eyes.
Whether you accept it, it's true. The Buggarts attacked us because hunters found one of their camps, got angry or scared, and shot them up. It breaks my heart that my own kind played a role in the death of my beautiful,
baby boy, but it happened, and I need you to deal with it. You need to deal with it.
Her eyes watered, her voice broke, and she turned away, pulling her knees up to her chest and wrapping her arms around them. He wanted to comfort her, to hold her, but he'd lost that right. So instead, he stared at his son's grave. He knew it was true the moment Paco told him that one of the men involved, drowning in guilt, had admitted that they'd attacked the Boggart camp first, provoking them. So why did he still hate them? Because the revelation changed nothing. Because they couldn't live together on the same world, not now. Never.
I dreamt of him last night, she said, her voice strong once more.
I envy you,
he whispered.
My dreams of Noah.
He sighed, his words falling away.
It was odd. He was with Elizabeth.
He watched her face in profile.
Elizabeth?
I barely knew her. Only met her before Taylor Bridge, but she struck me as a good person. But why dream of her and our son?
He didn't answer.
Maybe it's because we were linked through Cargan's crowns. Me, her, and Cassie. She told me not to worry, that Noah was safe, and we'd be together again.
Her lips curled into a faint smile.
Maybe it means something.
It was just a dream, but he didn't tell her that. Instead, he said,
Paco tells me the last of the children have gone to Cassie.
She nodded.
The ghosts. That's what they call them. Ghosts.
She sighed and shook her head.
Harsh, don't you think?
If I stop and think about anything, I'm not sure I can keep going.
I understand that.
Why don't you go as well? You can help Cassie. Helping the children would be good for you.
Maybe I will.
She whispered, rocking in place.
After we do this thing.
What thing?
Whatever you and your rangers have planned for this remnant camp, I'm coming with you.
He climbed to his feet, his posture stiffening.
The hell you are.
She rose and confronted him, looking like she was ready to go a few rounds.
My brother told me you're going out again tonight. I saw your team prepping. Whatever stupid thing you're planning on doing, you can't do it without a Madge Sense. So yes, I am coming with you. You don't get to tell me what I can't do.
Baby.
You don't get to call me that anymore either. I've already told Dallas and the others I'm coming. They're fine with it.
They're not in charge. I am.
According to Dallas, rangers get to vote. They voted. I'm coming. Don't be an idiot. You'll need me. Someone who can detect magic and protect you from their mages. Nobody shields like I do.
I have witchbane.
Which does nothing for the others and they know it. And don't even try saying I'll only get in the way, because I'm not a ranger or some such shit. Except for Sammy and Anji. Your team makes more noise than a pregnant caribou.
That wasn't true, he knew. Even Henry had become a skilled woodsman. But none of them could move like her.
He had no right to talk to my team without me.
Bullshit. I knew you'd say no.
And you'd have been right.
She shook her head in disgust and began to walk away. Alex reached out and caught her wrist, holding her in place.
Leela, please, listen. I know you're angry with me for leaving you.
For abandoning me after the death of our child, Alex. Say the words. Own your actions.
For abandoning you. I'm sorry, but I had no choice. After Noah, after I failed him, I couldn't.
You couldn't, Alex. You think you're the only one who failed Noah?
Her face darkened with anger and she ripped her hand free. Her eyes surged with emotion, rage, hatred, maybe even contempt. He had broken her, this once strong, proud woman, as he had broken their marriage, their life together. Her voice rose, spittle flying as she advanced on him and jabbed him in the chest with her finger.
I was here that night, not you. You were out doing your job, and I have...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.